Bio Vivacious. I'm Sebastian. Bio Vivacious is a YouTube channel dedicated to clear fundamentals of biosciences and make the subject exciting. Now let us finally look at the reactions of urea cycle. Now remember, urea cycle is the first known metabolic pathway elucidated. So it was in 1932. Urea cycle was elucidated by two very famous scientists. One is Hans Krebs, the same scientist who elucidated the TCA cycle. Another person who contributed to this is Kurt Hensoldt. So therefore, urea cycle is also known as Krebs and Hensoldt cycle, in honor of the discovery these two scientists have made. So the urea cycle consists of totally five steps, and it begins in the mitochondrial matrix. Remember, we have produced ammonia. Okay, so this is made available in the mitochondrial matrix. If the first reaction is to combine this ammonia with the bicarbonate ion and to produce a product called carbamoyl phosphate. Now, carbamoyl phosphate synthesis is catalyzed by an enzyme known as carbamoyl phosphate synthetase. Now, carbamoyl phosphate synthetase, which is present in the mitochondrial matrix, it's an isoenzyme. So type 1 is responsible for urea cycle. Type 2 is responsible for pyrimidine metabolism in nucleic acid. So we focus on this particular enzyme. Now this particular enzyme again is allosteric enzyme. We will be looking at the regulation later on, but this enzyme requires two ATP molecules. So therefore, it is an energy-driven process. So this enzyme is having about three active sites. And let us see, by using three active sites, how this reaction is catalyzed. I tried to summarize the first reaction which occurs in the mitochondrial matrix by carbamoyl phosphate synthetase, number one enzyme. So we have bicarbonate ion. So that combines with the ATP molecule, so therefore we are activating the bicarbonate ion. A phosphate group is added there, so it forms carboxyphosphate. That is the first step. Second step, what happens is an ammonium ion, which is already available in the mitochondrial matrix, is added to this, displaces the inorganic phosphate, and it forms carbamic acid. That is the second reaction. If the third reaction is now, so again catalyzed by the same enzyme, so it's having the three sites, so it is converting carbamic acid with the molecule of ATP is needed, so ADP, inorganic phosphate is added to carbamic acid. So therefore we can write it like this, this forms, so the amino group is there. Now to this, the phosphate group is added and we are getting carbamoyl phosphate. Okay, so I'll write the name carbamoyl phosphate. Carbamoyl phosphate. This is the end product of first step. So you can see that there are three reactions happening. One, two, and three reactions. And this is, if you look at the enzyme, so this large enzyme, the active sites are buried inside. So let me rub this portion. So the active sites are buried inside, and if you consider this is the enzyme, so if the substrate enters and if the product is released, so it forms intermediates in between, and it forms a kind of a channel. So therefore, this enzyme is an example of substrate channeling. So therefore, this enzyme acts as a substrate channel. Now, from this first active site to the last active site, it has a length of somewhere around 96 armstrong is the length, where the substrate is not allowed to diffuse away. It's allowed to pass through this, and finally, carbamide phosphate is formed. Strictly speaking, formation of carbamide phosphate is not really part of urea cycle. Real urea cycle begins from the next step. Okay, but we need carbamide phosphate as a starting material, as a precursor molecule. So therefore, we have dealt with this one, and it is also included in the urea cycle. Formation of 1 mole of carbamide phosphate requires investment of 2 moles of ATP. And you will see that these 2 ATP molecules are invested in order to make 2 covalent bonds. 1 covalent bond is between the carboxylic acid and the phosphoric acid. It forms an anhydride bond of carbamide phosphate, and the second is an amide bond. So energy is present in this molecule. This is the molecule that is going to be added to the next precursor molecule. That precursor molecule is ornithine. Now remember, ornithine is an amino acid derivative. So it is not a standard amino acid that can be incorporated into protein structure. So we will write the structure of ornithine like this. So this is the structure of ornithine. Now to this ornithine, carbamide phosphate is added. Now the inorganic phosphate is removed. Okay, and this region is added to ornithine to make citrulline. So this amide portion is added. Let us see what is the structure of citrulline. So I'll write the structure. The carbamide unit is added here, so you will see that, and it becomes citrulline. So now this is catalyzed by an enzyme which is there in the mitochondrial matrix that is called ornithine transcarbamylase. So this is the enzyme which is present in the mitochondrial matrix, ornithine transcarbamylase. Remember, ornithine and citrulline are derivatives of amino acid. They are not standard amino acid. What will happen now, since these reactions are happening in the mitochondrial matrix, the remaining reactions are going to take place in the cytoplasm. Now the citrulline has to be transported into the cytoplasm. Okay, and it will use something called an antipod mechanism for an outgoing citrulline. 1 ornithine will be transported back into the mitochondrial matrix. So the concentration is maintained. And now citrulline will come into the cytoplasm. There we have the step number 3. The third reaction in urea cycle is catalyzed by an enzyme known as arginino-succinate synthetase. So this is the enzyme which will catalyze the reaction. So we already have created citrulline. Now to this citrulline, aspartate is added. So aspartate will contribute in the second nitrogen of urea. So therefore, once you add aspartate, so this is the aspartate, and this is the region that has come from the carbamyl, this is from aspartate, carbamyl region, this is our ornithine. This product is called arginino-succinate. Now remember, this reaction requires an investment of energy. So ATP is hydrolyzed to AMP plus PPI. Okay, so therefore, huge investment of energy is needed for synthesizing arginino-succinate. Now, once arginino-succinate is synthesized, we move on to the fourth step. So in the fourth step, what happens is arginine-succinate is, so we will write arginine-succinate. So that is acted upon by a hydrolyzing enzyme, that is arginine-succinase enzyme. So arginine-succinase will act on arginine-succinate and it will result into fumarate. Okay, it will result into fumarate. It's the same fumarate which we have seen in TCS cycle, which will occur in the mitochondrial matrix. Now remember, this is taking place in the cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, fumarate is produced and the remaining is arginine, another amino acid. So this is what is happening in step number 4. Okay, let us write the structure of arginine. With that, we come to the last step of urea cycle. So this is the structure of arginine. Now remember, this is the guanidyl group, and we know that this is originally from ornithine, and this group has come from the carbamyl phosphate, and this has come from aspartate. So now in the last step, what happens is an enzyme called arginase. So this will act on arginine and urea is removed. Urea, the structure is NH2CONH2. Let me write it here, NH2CONH2. So this is the molecule, the ultimate end product of urea cycle. And the remaining will be converted to ornithine. So this ornithine will get back to mitochondrial matrix to go ahead to carry forward the complete the cycle of urea. So this is how the urea cycle happens. Now let us depict the whole thing in the form of a cycle. This is the complete urea cycle. So starting from ornithine, carbamyl phosphate is added and it forms citrulline. So the enzyme is ornithine transcarbamylase, the first enzyme. So this reaction will take place in the mitochondria. Then citrulline is brought out for an incoming ornithine, and by using a transporter called ORNT1. So once it is in the cytoplasm, so therefore this is in the cytoplasm, aspartate is added by an enzyme, ATP dependent reaction, where ATP is cleaved to AMP and PPI. The enzyme is arginine-succinate synthetase. So you get arginine-succinate. Then that is acted upon by arginine-succinase enzyme. So that is a third enzyme. So this is a second step. Then fumarate is formed, arginine is formed, arginine is acted upon by arginase enzyme, urea is formed, and ornithine. So this forms the complete urea cycle. What is important for us is now the fumarate which is formed here. What is the fate of the fumarate? So it is, remember, the fumarate is formed in the cytoplasm. Now what happens to this fumarate is, let's begin from here. So this fumarate is acted upon by an enzyme known as fumarase. So fumarase will convert fumarate into malate with the input of a molecule of water. So malate, once it is formed, you know that malate can very easily be converted to oxaloacetic acid by using MDH, malate dehydrogenase enzyme. So NAD plus, and it forms NADH plus H plus. Oxaloacetic acid is formed. Now oxaloacetic acid can very easily be converted to aspartate. So you know that aspartate becomes part of urea cycle. So that is how aspartate is replenished. So this is a transamination reaction. So to this keto acid, glutamate may be able to give an amino group to oxaloacetic acid, alpha ketoglutaric acid. Here is a transaminase enzyme. So this way, fumarate is ultimately converted to aspartate and the urea cycle can continue. This is a very important aspect. And finally, let us look at writing a stoichiometry and also to deal with the regulatory aspects. So in the stoichiometry for urea cycle, it can be written as, we began with a CO2 plus ammonia, that is what we want to discard, plus 3 ATP molecules have been used up, and we used an aspartate and 2 molecules of water. Okay, so from here, what are we getting? We got urea, we got 2 ADP and 2 PI. One of the ATP is converted to AMP plus PPI and a fumarate. Okay, so this is the complete reaction, complete stoichiometry for urea formation. So therefore, you can see that for forming urea, not exactly 3 ATP. One of the ATP is cleaved into AMP and PPI. So which is equivalent to 4 ATP equivalents. So have clarity on this. So effectively, we are using 4 ATP equivalents to synthesize 1 mole of urea.